following that give and takes of that maximal sort of efficiency and start compromising.
Right. Well, I guess you could make it, you go from a square to this shape.
Right, exactly. The square being a really, really basic GDC. Or a tetrahedron.
Right.
Like even more sort of primitive form.
So this, these were.
That's an ingenious design. That's your design or did you
Yeah, that's that? Mine.
That design is amazing.
So, never so some of the joints require four. Like these are the fake
GDC dominant. That's this setup over here. And Tom was just explaining it. I mean, Tom, why don't you take one of those, we just got a little bit of time here, and I want to hold the door for a minute to see you guys on your late arrivals. So Tom, you came up with this?
The idea was is I have been playing around with, one, I'm a Buckminster Fuller fan, and I wanted to build a tent, you know, a structure that my daughter could put a sheet over or something like that. So I thought it'd be cool to build a geodesic dome and geodesic. We're gonna have to figure out what it
we'll
is.
Figure that out,
so yeah. So these we later, if you guys would like to, we can actually put this together. It's like a puzzle, but you just start fitting in the dowels to these joints, and this is just hose from that's sold by the foot at Lowe's and Home Depot. And if you saw my Geek Dad presentation, I hang out at Lowe's and Home Depot. And I should just buy stock there. But that I started building this, and probably the most expensive thing out of this whole thing is this, these dowels. They're not cheap. But my next one is building it out of, I want to build something similar out of PVC pipe. Because that's cheap, that's inexpensive.
There's another construction too that uses conduit piping.
Yes.
And you take the rounded conduit piping, and at the end you smash it flat, and then drill it, and then you can line up the holes of those flattened edges and drop a bolt down through it.
Just like they do with the plate joints.
Exactly.
Yes, exactly. Just like exactly. That. Using a probably much lighter weight, I would imagine, material, and they're probably using something more rugged than that, because if I'm not mistaken, it's probably like aluminum or something like that. Don't know if it would be climbable, like playground equipment. You might wind up.
I have seen people doing that, and that's actually one of the things that fascinates me about these domes is that they're much stronger for their size than you think that they should be. They can suspend more weight.
Yeah, that triangular.
Yeah.
That triangular aspect of it. Tom earlier today did the Geek Dad talk. Many of you may have seen it. There he goes. He's showing his colors. And your website, you got tomhatch.com. And is geekdad.com yours?
No, I wish it was, but Ken Denby is the owner of geekdad.com.
And if you saw Tom's, come on in, folks,
come on
if you
down.
Saw Tom's presentation, then he spoke a bit about some of the different things that are going on in town as far as trying to motivate young people to get interested in technology. And it's really something that Tom and I have forged a recent friendship over, and he and I are very like-minded about this. I have my company, Tek-Kids, where I'm taking programs around to area schools and doing after-school and enrichment programs for young people. And I set up my own workshops as well, and I'll be doing summer camps this summer. There's information about a lot of this up here. Another thing, too, I want to let everybody know about is that I run a computer programming club downtown. Sawyer, raise your hand. Sawyer comes almost every single week. It's for young people. No previous experience is necessary. Just an interest in computer programming or technical topics. I have kids coming down there, boxes full of computer parts that they want to take apart. I've got students showing up with laptops that want to set up a Minecraft server and play Minecraft for a while. The whole range and gamut. And then I've got students showing up with no laptop. They just want to hang out. And I put that together primarily because I wanted kids that I knew from different parts of Asheville to have a place where they could come together and meet one another. Because I'm meeting so many interesting kids in different areas of Asheville, and I think to myself, this kid, if he ever met that kid, they'd get along so well. So I wanted to create kind of a meeting point. And so there's some information up here about that. I'll put a couple of these on the table about the computer programming club. It is free and open to the public. All ages, all experience levels are welcome. Grown-ups come down and hang out too. It's not a workshop or a class, it's a club. This is just to let you know about a main workshop I'll be doing on an introduction to video game design. So I've just taken that class before. Introduction to video game design. for students in the age ranges of around 9 to 12. This is a well-suited workshop, and that's starting on Monday, but it's not too late to register if anybody's interested, and I can show you the software that we use. But I think we should get down to talking about electronics now. So, let me fire up my PowerPoint presentation here. So if you enjoy your time here in the workshop, I hope that you'll feel free to find me on Facebook and like my page for Tek-Kids. I hope that you'll also consider checking out my summer camp schedule, which is up on the web, and I'll pass these out at the end, and I've got a copy of the schedule here, including a new and very popular Minecraft camp that I'm going to be running this summer. Join me down at the Computer Programming Club on Saturdays at the Pack Memorial Library. Please do sign up for the mailing list if you're interested in that. Days like today, I can't be there, and I like to be able to let everybody know on a day when I can't be there. So please do sign up for the mailing list. I'm there almost every Saturday. But on the rare occasion when I can't make it, it's good to be able to let people know. And then I have a tech shop class in May called Introduction to Video Game Design. It's going to be in West Asheville, Mondays at 4 p.m. So, oh yeah, you can sign up for my mailing list. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about safety before we get started. How many people in here, young people and grown-ups, have had an opportunity to build an electronic circuit, make a light bulb light up, maybe an LED light up, make something blink on and off, maybe? Okay, great, good, excellent. So we got a bunch of veterans in here. That's awesome. Good. I'm going to be handing out the kits in a moment. As you all know, electronics and electricity are a lot of fun, but we need to know a couple things about safety before we get started, right? And for our purposes, we're going to be working with a 9-volt battery. So the one thing we want to be concerned about is keeping that 9-volt battery safe at all times. We're not going to get into too much trouble with it. It's not going to hurt us. But what it can do is it can get super hot if we're not careful with it. We should accidentally short it out. So we have to be aware of that. Anytime we set our project up and we add the power, we're going to add the power last. We're going to set everything up first. We're going to add our power last. And if it doesn't do what we expect it to do when we plug in the battery, we're going to unplug the battery right away. And then we're going to figure out what's wrong while the battery's off. So we don't do any damage by accidentally having maybe a short in there or something. So we want to be conscious about the battery when we're in here. One important rule when you get interested in electronics, and I hope everybody in this room decides that they want to pursue electronics projects because they're wonderful and they're magical and you can do just absolutely incredible and wonderful things with them. But you must always work with a qualified adult nearby, okay? Because electricity is no joke, right? It's serious stuff. We do projects with small batteries and we keep it safe that way. Things that plug into the wall can be seriously dangerous. Right? And it's not up to the students to be able to know the difference between a project that's going to be fun and awesome and one that's potentially dangerous. That's for an adult to decide. Always. Okay, so always be working with a qualified adult nearby. Here's some important things for us to think about while we're in this class. Here you can see I've got this 9-volt battery hooked up to a battery clip, and here are the two leads or the wires coming off of the battery. And they're awfully close to one another right there. And should they accidentally touch, there could be a tiny spark right there, and that's creating a short. A short is any time positive touches directly to negative, and the power starts flowing rapidly through there, okay? And more than the spark that's dangerous, what would be dangerous is the heat that's going to start to generate from that battery. It's all that electricity starts flowing very quickly through there. So for that reason, we don't want to leave our batteries looking like this. Unplug the battery from the battery clip to make your project super safe, okay? That's one important thing for us to think about. Whenever we're working on our projects, leave the battery unplugged. Don't store the 9-volt battery with the other components. Everybody's going to walk out of here today with one of these little plastic bags full of fun little electronic parts, right? So that you go home and recreate these things. And you're going to leave here with a 9-volt battery. Don't put the 9-volt battery inside the Ziploc baggie and take it home, right? Does any of the young people in here have an idea of why that's an important safety tip? What do you think, Sawyer?
We'll probably do something, like the battery could touch something and then it makes bad.
You're exactly right. While it's in here, if a piece of metal was to simultaneously touch the positive and the negative, that's a short and it's going to get hot. Okay? So this goes separate from these things, right? And also along those lines, and this is something important to know just in general, don't shove a 9-volt battery in your pocket. Why?
Coins?
What kinds of metal things do you carry in your pockets that it might touch when it goes into your pocket?
Change.
Change, yeah, coins, exactly right. Did you have another thought?
No, that was
Same thing you were going to say, right? Keys, grown-ups tend to carry keys when kids do, right? But keys in your pocket, too, could be another thing that could cause some depression. So don't put the 9-volt battery into your pocket. I've got a little bit of masking tape here and one piece of masking tape over the top of your 9-volt battery, which is nice and safe to carry out of your patents. All right, this is our breadboard. I'm going to go ahead and start handing these kits out. Those of you that are standing along the side, you can feel free to join us here. You can just grab a little table edge and be a part of this workshop. We've got 10 kits to give out. I'm giving one per family to take home. Come on in here, find yourself some table space, and if you don't have a plastic bag, just holler at me and let me know. Yep. Now, how many people in the room, young and old, have used a breadboard before? Have you really? Congratulations. Good. You're well ahead of the game if you've used one of these things before. You've used one before, Sawyer. Did you do internal electronics with me? No, you didn't. But you've used one on your own? Wonderful. Great. Okay. Well, the breadboard is what we're going to use to connect electronic components. Electricity can't flow unless there's a contact that's happening. Things literally have to touch one another in order for the current to flow through them. But we don't have enough fingers on our hands or enough hands on our body to be able to hold all the components simultaneously together. So we use a breadboard. The breadboard's got all these holes in it, right? And it's got enough holes to hold all of these components in it for us. And it's going to make connections for us. Easy connections, easy to make, and easy to take apart. Up here, you can see these magical yellow lines that just appeared are there to help you to visualize how the connections are being made. If I plug my battery into row 1A, and I plug an LED into row 1E, those two components are now connected as though they were touching one another. There's a tiny strip of metal under there. They both touch the same piece of metal underneath the green plastic. Okay? So we can plug components in here. So I want you to be watching as I throw images up here of circuits on here. Watch for the connectivity that's happening in the rows, the connections that are being made in the rows. Notice that the yellow line doesn't go across the middle. Okay? So there is no connection from this point to this point over here. Okay? And that's deliberate for when we use chips, which comes later on. They need that separation from when we use chips. Here we've got a basic circuit, and we're pretty much ready to get started on building. Does anybody have any questions before we start actually assembling our first circuit? What's your question, Yonder? Iron Man, do you have a question?
Yeah.
Do you want to share it with us?
Yeah.
You share it with your daddy. Daddy can let us know what your question is, and we'll get you an answer, okay? All right, so what we're going to do is we're going to start off with some connections here. Notice my battery is not connected. So what we want to do is start to emulate this. Now, you know from what I've said in the past, and I've got some pictures that get closer up on this, but you know that we're trying to match rows. So even if you can't literally see the wire on this LED being placed into the same row as this resistor, you know we're trying to connect these parts. And so we're putting them in common rows up here. And the flow of the electricity goes through the red wire into the LED, down through the LED, the resistor, and then back to negative. Right? And so we're always making these loops, right? Like we're traveling like a bunch of errands, right? Take off in the morning with your car, drive to the LED. After the LED, you're going to have to stop by the resistor, and then you're back home again to the battery. Okay? So let's go ahead and start to put this together. And I've got some images on here that take us in just a little bit closer so that you can actually see that connectivity that's happening there by sharing the rows. Once you've got all the components on there and you double-checked your connections to make sure that they are in fact in the same row, it's very easy to get things into neighboring rows and think that they are connected when in fact they're in rows just next to one another. There is an amazing spot. Has everybody discovered this spot in the room right here where your voice?
Yeah,
it sounds like you're this bizarre. Have you seen that film?
Yes.
Standing right here, mocking your own voice. There's like a sweet spot right there.
Ooh, that's kind of cool.
Yeah.
I think this is usually
that. All right, and then once you're sure that your connections look good, you're welcome to plug that 9-volt battery in, remembering our important safety tip that if it doesn't do what you expect it to do, and in this case we're expecting it to light the LED, if it doesn't do what you expect it to do right away, first remove the power. Then we'll figure out what's wrong with it. But the longer we leave the battery on there, if the cause of our problem is a short, the hotter that battery is going to be getting moment by moment.
That's
going to
look like your...
Yes, sorry. Oh, I forgot I have to hand out batteries too. I was withholding that, right? Withholding the magic. Absolutely. Are you comfortable down there, Joseph?
Yes.
Of course. Right. You guys are here. One, two.
Thank you.
Absolutely. All right, I see one LED glowing over there. Nice work. Nice work. And while you guys are working on this, I'll just be buzzing around in your ear talking a little bit about what we're doing here. We've got two basic components. We're all well familiar with the battery clip, and why we're going to need those. But we've got this LED light here. Does anybody in the room know what LED stands for? LED?
Lighting.
Okay. That's something like that. Mostly will be over 20 words. No, that's fine. I was just looking for an answer from anybody, but okay, so the LED is our light emitting diode. We won't worry too much about that last word, diode, but the first two, light emitting, giving off light. Okay. And then we've got this crazy little thing that looks like an amp. When you look at it on my screen, it looks like it's rather large. But when placed in front of you, it's actually very tiny, inside of a tiny little sugar amp. That's called a resistor. And the resistor does exactly what its name implies. It's resisting the flow of current. It's pushing back against the current. Okay? Now the current is the flow of the electrons through there. If we send too much current through that LED, just like a light bulb, we could blow it. We could blow it, we could permanently kill the LED. Now, a well-made LED operating under the right current can continuously operate longer than I'll be on this planet. 100 years. It's a very efficient light source. Yes. An LED can operate continuously for 100 years.
This one?
Well, I started off by saying a well-constructed one. And you can imagine that when I shop for parts for the classroom, I'm not necessarily buying the most expensive LED. But the difference between the sort of very cheap economy LEDs and the really nice ones, well, I don't know, you can spend a lot of money. But it is a very efficient light source, and many of you probably know from your houses that there's a push to change lights over to LED light sources. The resistor is pushing back against the current to prevent there from being too much current flowing through the LED, which would be dangerous to the LED. Not dangerous to us. If the LED was to overload, it would simply work for a moment and then not work anymore and never work again. And you'd notice a tiny little stink coming off of the LED. It would emit a little chemical odor as it gasped and died. Did you get it to work? That looks wonderful. Nice job. Have you ever lit up an LED before?
No.
No? Congratulations. You're an electronics wizard now, buddy. Good for you. All right. Now, taking a look from the side. Notice that the LED, I've bent this knee out on the LED. I'm going to have to watch time here because I'm definitely going to go over. I'm a very long-winded individual, so. Help me to know if I'm going off on too much of a tangent. We've got about 5 circuits I want to build today. Notice that I bent this little knee here onto the LED. If you were to install that LED backwards, which is not something I would advise you experimenting with your electronic components, because you can damage them, it would not damage the LED. But the LED would not light up. And you're welcome to verify that for yourself if you want to. You can pick the LED up, turn it around, plug it in backwards. It will not pass current through it. It will not damage the LED. It will not damage your circuit. It simply won't pass current through it in the other direction, and that's actually one of the important features of a diode. It's a one-way street for our current, and it can protect our current in case we accidentally hooked our batteries up in reverse. That one-way street can actually be a very helpful thing to have. Now, resistors don't just come in one value. These colored stripes on the side are actually a code indicating the value of the resistor, and we can have different values of resistors. If I increase the value of the resistor, I'm decreasing the amount of current and the LED is getting dimmer. If I'm dropping the level of the resistance, the current is increasing and the LED can get brighter. Take a look here. Now, if you dig around in your kit, you can find a couple of more resistors in there. And now I'm setting my resistors up to what's called a series, like the World Series, right? Or a television series, one after the other. I'm setting my resistors up into a series. It may not be immediately apparent, but each of these resistors shares a row with another resistor. That's the connection. So again, just like our errand, you know, we were running our errands during the day, we left our home, which was the battery, went to the LED, went to the first resistor, second resistor, third resistor, and then we went home.
Do I have to be in line?
You mean vertically aligned.
In the sense that every terminal end of a resistor has to be on the same row as the next resistor.
That's correct. That's right. That's how we're passing the current. Underneath that breadboard are tiny strips of wire, and plugging something into that row makes physical contact with that tiny wire, which then makes contact with other components plugged into the same row. But do remember that that connection ends in the middle. It doesn't bridge across the middle. That connection doesn't bridge across the middle. Now, it's a little bit subtle to see, but if you've got those three resistors in a row, can you see the difference from the first circuit to the second? What does adding more resistors in a row do to our current? What does it do to our current? What does it do to our LED light, really, is the question. What do you see, Joseph?
Less power.
So you're seeing a dimmer LED, in other words, with the three?
You can always take this out, leave those resistors in, and put this in alignment with that one.
Yeah. I've got a slide to show exactly what Tom was just describing. What, so like it passed all of these multiple views. It's like a real estate presentation here. Watch this slide change to this slide, and you'll see that pulling the negative power out and plugging it in again up here gives our root, our errands, only goes through one LED and one resistor before returning home. So if you want to, you can compare plugging the black wire in all the way at the bottom to plugging the black wire up here and see what the difference is as you move that black wire up and down between those two rows. And you can visually compare the difference. Visually compare. And I want to know what you're discovering as you try that little test back and forth. Can people see a difference? Or if you're having a hard time making this little thing work, and again, it's going back and forth sort of between connecting, go back. Connecting down here at the bottom versus connecting in here at the top. We could also make the connection here if we wanted to see what it would be like to have two resistors in a series and then returning back. What are you guys seeing? What do you see when you compare those two circuits? Was Joseph right? Is there less power with more resistors?
Is that the way to language it, though, to say that it's less power? Or because right now power is flowing through the black up, so to speak, upwards towards the light?
Yeah, I mean, there's two different ways of expressing it, and the more scientifically accurate way to express it is the electron flows from negative to positive. I usually, when I'm discussing with students, talk about it flowing from positive to negative, only because it's a little easier for them to sort of see origin in the beginning of the circuit, down through to the end of the circuit, output is usually the end. So there's a variety of reasons for convenience that I use that. You're right, electron flow actually does go negative to positive, right? Because electrons are negatively charged, so that's what? The source of our electron. But I adopt a kind of
convention. If that was the case, though, if that was the flow, then the LED would not be affected by the resistors.
It does, and that's kind of an interesting point. I'll make a really quick point about this because there's so many detours we can go off on. But Tom's asking about the position of the resistors, and I would encourage anybody who feels like they have a moment to try this. If we did, back on our original one, and it went from red power to LED to resistor to black wire, is there a difference between that and going red wire to resistor to LED and back to the red wire, back to the black wire? And there is not. Because you have to think of it as being like a garden hose with water pressure in it. And if you go up to the top of the water hose and you squeeze it, it cuts the water supply at that end, but the rate of flow changes before your hand too. You've decreased the rate of flow for the whole stream.
Okay.
Right? So even though there's more pressure on one side than there is on the other, the rate of flow, which is current, is consistent.
I see.
Right? And it doesn't matter where on the hose you squeeze it. Okay? So that's kind of the basic idea. How's it going over there? What did you find out? Yeah. Oh, you turned it around, did you?
And so the power then, tell me what happened. That's good.
Okay, turning the LED around. Yeah.
And then reverse the terminal.
Oh, and then hooking your 9-volt battery connection backwards, right? Where it won't actually plug in, but you can rest it on there, and then you saw it flowing in the other direction. And so that's the idea of the flow of the current from the battery flowing one way or the current flowing the other way. And current is the movement of the electrons, and that's what's making that thing like a wonderful discovery. Did it fry the LED? It died, yeah, exactly, without the resistor there. Hold on, I think I've got a scare right here.
Oh, did it? You took the resistor out of the
machine? Yeah, by moving the black wire up even further.
It killed the LED.
Yeah.
How long did the LED survive?
2 seconds.
2 seconds, there you go.
So would a better LED work longer?
Different LEDs can handle different currents. Even different colors of LEDs will have different specs on them. A green LED versus a red one, for example. Okay, let's try another project. Did anybody independently confirm what Joseph told us, which was that moving it down and including more resistors made it darker? Did anybody see that? Show of hands, did anybody see that? A little bit? A little bit? Okay. It's kind of a subtle difference, but the best way to see it is to sort of AB it, as they say, go back and forth. Now, I'm returning this back to its original circuit. Is that the dead one? What's that? Oh, it's huge? Oh, I see what you mean. It's like bent too widely. Try this one instead. That's a little more similar. Okay, now I'm returning this back to what it was originally. What did you change? The LED? Yeah, go ahead. And now look inside your kit for one of these little gizmos right here. This is a little tiny miniature push button switch. And what we want our switch to do is what we want most switches to do, turn the power on and off. Okay? Now, where do we include that? And remember what I said before about how when we look at this, we can sort of visualize it like we're running errands. So let's trace our path. We started off with the battery, we hit the board, we went through the switch. The switch is connected to the LED, the LED is connected to the resistor, and then we drive back home again to the battery. Complete circuit, just like a roadmap, right? It's a complete circuit, beginning with the battery, ending with the battery. And hopefully now we can see our tiny little switch working for us to turn the LED on and off. If anybody's struggling with any of this, please don't hesitate to raise your hand, even if I'm off on some sort of a long-winded explanation about something. Good. Okay, good. That's the original circuit. And then you're ready to bring that little tactile switch in there. Excellent. Yeah.
So you're bridging on the board. Remember, this side is not connected to this side. So you need something going from the other side. Look
at that. All right. I see some success at some different tables as I see LEDs flickering on and off rapidly. What's that? You have to what? Yeah, you have to hit it and you have to hold it. If you don't hold it, it doesn't stay on, right? So we call a momentary push button switch. There's more specifically called tactile switches because they have that, you can feel that dunk, 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 as you're pushing on them. So they're called tactile switches. And this is just about the smallest switch I've seen. Yeah, absolutely. Out your bedroom window. Against our neighbor?
There's
nanos. Parents are almost asleep. Be over. Oh, no, sorry, guys. Right, sorry. Don't do that.
This is called a tactile switch?
Yeah, with that feeling of pressing it. You get that? They call that tactile.
And it was designed for this breadboard?
Well, yeah, breadboard spacing is a standard thing. For many reasons in electronics, they have standard spacings. And so this space right here is a standard, and this space right here is a standard. So that was designed specifically to be able to bridge that gap there. But you can turn your switch vertically, and it would also drop nicely into the rows. So again, it was designed with some forethought. Okay. By show of hands, does anybody need more time with their tactile switch project? I want to kind of move us forward so that we don't run out of time too abruptly. I have a number of cool projects, and as you can imagine, as we get more and more into this, the projects get a little neater and a little neater, okay? Okay, now for this one, you're going to have to look closely at how I'm wiring things up, and we'll have different angles to look at this. You can notice a couple of things. First of all, testing out Tom's theory, I've reversed the position of the LED and the resistor. It's not something you necessarily have to do with your project, but if you haven't tried it already to verify something that Tom and I were discussing in a side conversation, You can, and you'll see that they work exactly the same. Whether the LED comes first, resistor second, or the other way around, it does not matter. Yeah. Now we've got this wonderful device, which has a knob on it, which rotates, right? Reminds us of, like, what kinds of household devices does that remind you of, that kind of rotating movement?
The oven?
The oven has one, fantastic. What other devices have a knob that rotates and makes a change on the device?
Volume.
Volume, excellent. Volume on the stereo, right? Turn it one way to make it louder. We want to use this knob in the same exact way, just like on the oven. When you crank it, it gets hotter. Crank it the other way, it gets colder. We want to see this knob do the same thing with our LED light in terms of making it brighter and making it dimmer. Now, you've got three leads on that knob. The fancy name for that knob, potentiometer. The nickname for it, pot. All the guys that are electronics nerds are going to be talking about the pot. That's the pot. Notice from above, here are the three leads. One of the leads is connected to a row that's empty. One of the leads is connected to the negative battery there. Oops, okay, we're going closer, so much the better. And the other lead is connected to the resistor. Okay? So you want to use this edge pin and the center pin, and the remaining edge pin is unconnected. That is deliberate. Okay? That's deliberate.
So put the negative lead in the middle parts?
The negative lead is connected to the center post. Yeah, or the center pin or the lead. Any of those terms will work just nicer. The black lead is connected to the center, and the edge is connected to that resistor. And this is our plain resistor LED combo that's keeping the resistor is keeping the LED safe from the full current of that 9-volt battery. Otherwise, it goes from 100 years of continuous operation to 2 seconds. Wonderful, yes, exactly right. And hopefully you can see that when you're turning the knob, you're affecting the brightness.
What if you didn't have the resistor? Okay. The potentiometer is not resisting enough?
Okay, good question. The potentiometer is a resistor. It is a resistor, and that's why turning it is affecting the brightness. Right? It's a variable resistor. We can change the level of resistance on it by turning the knob. Okay. Tom's question, why do we have a variable resistor and a fixed resistor? Does anybody have a thought, an answer for that question? Why do we need both the variable resistor and the fixed resistor in there? Sawyer.
Because it would be harder to,
A thought went away. Just flew away, right? Anybody have a thought?
I might know. It depends on the spec of the potentiometer.
The variable resistor? Yeah, and the specs of this, you want to jump in on your own question?
So when the potentiometer is full on, there's no resistance.
When it's fully cranked in one direction, the resistance drops to zero.
So that's why you have to have...
And so you need the fixed resistor in there, because as we found in a previous thing, when you put two resistors in a row, they add their resistance together. So when this one hits zero, we still have this much resistance in our thing, keeping our LED safe. From there, we can increase the overall resistance by turning the knob.
Okay.
And it goes up to 10,000. When it's done.
Would you blow up the LED if you connect it directly to the pot?
If you then crank it down to zero, yes, with a 9-volt battery, yep. That would be in essence no resistor. Right? That would be in essence no resistor. And yeah, we'd see that 2-second lifespan.
Okay.
Does anybody need any help with this? There's a kind of a trickiness with this that can hang some people up about the fact that we've got three leads and we're only using two of them. That can be a little bit tricky for some people.
What happens if you use the third one that we're not using and plug into there?
Well, the question is which two you're using. So what's the combination? If we use this edge and this center pin, we get a nice variable resistor. If we use this edge and this center pin, we also get a nice variable resistor, but the action is reversed.
Okay.
If we use this edge pin and this edge pin, we have a fixed resistor at 10,000 that can't be changed.
The two outside.
The two outside creates a fixed resistor of the full value of the variable.
What if you use all three?
Mm-hmm.
What if you use all three?
Use all three, then you can do some interesting things where you can, as you turn the knob, it increases the resistance for one part of your circuit while simultaneously decreasing it for another part of your circuit. And so you can get some kind of interesting results from doing that. You can also create a cool device, and I'm not going to go too far down this rabbit hole, but you can create a very cool and useful device called a voltage divider, which has a lot of really interesting applications. That's a sort of an intermediate concept in electronics, so I'm not going to go too far down that. But one potentiometer gives you a nice way to create a voltage divider.
So theoretically, you have another resistor coming out other end, another LED, as you turn it, one would get brighter, one would get...
Yeah, and if you replicated your positive power connection on this side of the board too, which you could do with one of the jumper wires that you all see, you jumper wire power over here, and I think you've only got one LED in the case, so you wouldn't be able to try this today, but with a quick trip to Radio Shack, you could try that. Jumpering the positive power over here, LED resistor coming into this side, and as you're describing, turning it would simultaneously be like a seesaw. One gets brighter while the other gets brighter.
I like that.
Yeah. See, the idea is to start popping about how these different things can sort of work together. Does anybody need more time with that variable resistor potentiometer? Okay, here's a really cool little gizmo. Also goes to the category of variable resistors. This guy's called LDR, light dependent resistor. So this is a varying resistor, and his value depends on how much light is shining on him. So what we want to do is we're going to take the potentiometer out of that last circuit. We're going to unplug our battery, make our circuit safe. Take the potentiometer out, and we should be able to use the same two holes we were just using a moment ago to plug in the LDR. Now, the LDR is going to add resistance to the circuit. We're keeping our fixed resistor in there, same thing, just good practices. You've got a variable resistor, we're backing it up with one fixed resistor to make sure our resistance doesn't get so low that it's dangerous for the circuit. And then what we want to see is if we get this wired up correctly, I'm going a little closer. If we get this wired up correctly, you can't see the pins connecting under here, but you know from your work already with the breadboard that it has to be making these connections. Okay. So we wanted to share the rows with those. We should be able to make the LED's brightness vary by covering up and uncovering the LDR.
See that? I can.
Sometimes you have to put your right on top of the LDR. So as it gets darker, the resistance increases and the LED gets dimmer. It's kind of like a reverse nightlight. It gets darker at night and brighter in the day.
What is that thing called again?
LD, it's actually got a few different names. LDR, light dependent resistor. It's also called a photoresistor. And it's also called a photostat. Okay.
So if you plug this in, your
cord is going to
get lighter.
Sorry, you plug which
is the
If you put it into full brightness, you might get the resistance down so low that you effectively did not have a resistor there, and it could be dangerous for the LED. That LDR generally will not go low enough to really be dangerous to the LED. I kind of include this just because it's a good practice to be in. We want to make sure that no matter what happens with our variable resistor, our resistance doesn't drop below that basic level that we need to keep our LED safe. How are people doing with this? Is anybody having a hard time getting this one rigged up? Everybody's seeing that if you press your thumb over the surface of the LDR, that you can make it the brightness change. So now our circuits are actually able to sense and respond in a very direct way to the environment. Right? So here's the beginnings of the ability of our circuit to sense its surroundings and decide or respond based on what's going on around it. Actually, not entirely, because touchscreens are based on, they're called capacitive touchscreens. So it's actually based on the conductivity of your skin. In that situation, it's nothing to do with the conductivity of your skin, just the opaqueness of your finger, right? So we can do the same thing with a styrofoam cup or with a piece of cardboard that we're doing with your finger. That's not true of touchscreens. It actually needs to be a finger which is capable of conducting a small amount of electricity to do that. So not seeing technology. Anybody else have any questions and thoughts about the LDR? Super cool little gizmo. Combine that thing up with some transistors and you can have a lot of fun making responsive circuits responding to their environments. Okay, good. So we're getting ready for a new circuit here. We're going to include some capacitors. Those are the barrel-shaped things. But we're going to get our board ready to receive those capacitors. So we're going to kind of rearrange things just a little bit here. I'm starting my circuit off intentionally with a switch. We're going to need that switch up at the top. Because we want to have a circuit where we can cut the power to the circuit. The top, that's the tiny tactile switch. The miniature push-button switch. And it's running vertically this time. Thank goodness for those standardized measurements that make our lives so easy.
The next
one.
The LED's going to share the row with us.
And when you're done with this, you should have the same circuit, essentially, that we built about three or four projects back when we first tested that push-button switch.
Called in sequence?
This hookup right here in series.
Series,
yeah. Yeah. The contrasting concept of that song is parallel. Right.
Yes.
Right.
Should it light up?
Push the button, it lights up. When you let it go, it doesn't. Is that true with your story?
No.
Check your rows. It's not lighting up at all. Check your rows to make sure. There we go. Something maybe wasn't pushing all the way. Those tactile switches will fall out, they'll kind of rock side to side and pop out of there. So you gotta kind of go back and check them. That's both the best thing and the worst thing about the prototyping board, the breadboard, is it makes your disconnects and reconnects very easy, but components will also shake loose. And that can be a little frustrating at times as you go around and constantly push the same components back in. All right, so let's talk about our capacitor. That's the side angle of it. The capacitor is the barrel-shaped component. Again, you'll notice that with these, I've bent one of the legs forward. That's intentionally to signify that there's an in and an out to this component, or a positive and a negative. That's not true with our resistors. We can hook our resistors up one way, spin them around, it doesn't make a difference. With the capacitor, we gotta make sure we get the knee pointing in the right direction. In this case, the knee is pointing over to the right side of the board, and connecting to the same row as the LED and the switch does. The other side of the capacitor is across the board, so it's not electronically connected because of this divide. I've got other pictures that'll show a little
bit. We have two capacitors. Which one should we use?
Okay, I've got the one with the number 1,000 plugged in there. That's the biggest, the highest value one, and I think it's kind of the stoutest one, not the tallest one, but the stoutest one. What's that? It's the big tubby capacitor. Yeah, exactly. There's a taller one, but you can also read the numbers on the side. This one's got the number 1,000 on the side of it. The second highest one is 470, and then we've got 100 in there. So we've got three different ones we're going to test. Okay. Now, here's the jumper wire. It's the first time we've used one of these. There's no special magic or voodoo to it. It's not even a component. It's simply a wire that we use to connect one part of the board to the other. It doesn't do any special magic other than make a connection. And in this case, it's connecting to ground for our negative battery. Okay, and delivering that around. Now, Sawyer, did you have a chance to test it?
Not yet.
Not yet, okay. Well, if your connections look good, let's wire it up and see what it does. You guys can report back to us on what the effect of the capacitor is.
Oh, cool.
Let go.
Yeah, let go.
Oh my God, it fades.
It fades out.
Nice.
Fades out. Oh, it's working. Okay. Something probably just wasn't all the way down in the hall.
Come on over and grab a chair over here.
Excuse me.
Yeah.
Is the leg has to intersect with the terminal?
Yes.
We're
gonna try to get.
Oh, it's okay. I'm fine. Don't worry. I'm just getting him when he's speaking.
Yeah,
so
yeah,
this will get cut out. Yeah, they are going to start over. They're going to start over.
Yeah,
so
we signed up for two.
Oh, you signed up for two? You know what? You might want to just wait.
Yeah.
Okay. But you can watch a little bit and learn as we go.
Yeah, that's fine.
So, you know what time it is?
12 minutes before.
Okay.
This is our last circuit, so we're actually doing really well. Okay, so how many people have seen the capacitor doing its magic? Yeah, Sawyer, give us a little description of what this gizmo does.
It's the thing
you
fade out.
Yeah, it's making it fade out. Do we have any ideas about what this thing is doing that's causing a fade out as opposed to the sharp on and sharp off?
I think the capacitor is actually temporarily absorbing energy or electron flow.
Yep. Yeah, you got it.
That's a mini battery.
It's a tiny little rechargeable battery. That's exactly right. And what the capacitors are really good for is smoothing out current that might otherwise be a little jumpy. If we've got an unequal or an inconsistent power supply, a capacitor will, when there's tons of power, absorb that power, and when the power is depleted and gone away, it will release it back in. So where before you'd be able to switch it on and off and have a nice little Morse code indicator, your Morse code indicator is kind of ruined a little bit now. Because as you switch it on and off, you don't see it going on and off, right? That's a more consistent kind of a power supply that you're getting, right? It doesn't work so well for Morse code, but when you've got something that needs a constant power supply, it does a nice job.
And you turn it on and take a battery off,
it's still fading out, isn't it? Now you can try simply, you should be able to switch swap out that big capacitor with 1,000 on it, take it off, and replace it with a number 470.
Wait a second.
And see the difference between 470 and 1,000.
Now push the button.
It won't fade, right? As long as you're holding it. And then as soon as you decide to let go of it, what happens? It starts to fade at that point, right? Did you try another capacitor besides the first one? You've got two more capacitors. Try taking that first capacitor out and putting a second capacitor in its place and see if you can tell me what the difference is.
What's this is mu, right?
That's the symbol for micro. I don't know which Greek letter it is off the top of my head.
And what is the S on the
book? Farads. Farads are how they measure capacitance. So that is 1,000 microfarads, which I guess is a millifarad. I'm doing my math correctly. I get a little lost in the zeros. But yeah, and the farad is named for Michael Faraday. That's a historical side. Okay, that's right, we get a faster fade-out time when our number goes down. So the capacitance is telling us, that rating on there, that number 1,000, is telling us how much can it store, right? And when that number goes up and it's storing more, it has the ability to let that energy out over a longer period of time for our LED. Curious to note that if any of you have ever noticed when you take a flash camera and you take a picture, you push the button, you gotta wait 2 seconds.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
That's the capacitors, and they're filling up so that they can poof, send a lot of power through the flash. More than your batteries can send through there. Your batteries are limited for how much current they're gonna be able to supply. So instead, you charge up a bunch of capacitors in the camera. It takes a moment, and you used to be able to hear the noise. You hear the poof, right? The capacitors charging up, and then poof, they release all that power. So capacitors have that ability to charge quickly and release energy quickly, rapidly, creating a lot of current. They're also the thing that make high wattage appliances very dangerous, because they store power. So anytime you open up a TV or a computer and you see capacitors that are easily 10 times bigger than the capacitor there, those are the boogeymen that are lurking inside the circuit that could potentially be holding a lot of charge inside of them. Which is why you should not be working on components that plug into the wall. You should not be opening those up without a qualified adult, because they may hold charging even after they're unplugged from the wall. They can remain dangerous. And it's these capacitors that they
play. Okay, I got a question to you.
Yeah.
Joseph and I just put all of our capacitors on here.
Yes.
In an effort to store more electricity.
Yeah.
And it seems to make no difference.
Yes, that's right. The big question is, how did you connect them? Right? Are they connected more in parallel, or are they connected more in series? Are all the negative ends facing connected to the same row?
We didn't pay attention to that.
Yeah, that's another important thing. The big determiner of that is going to be the how of the connection. How are they connected? By the way, just for people who are sitting in the door, we're wrapping up the first session, getting ready for the next, so don't go away. This is not the second session, we're wrapping up the first. So stick around, we're going to have another session starting up in just a few minutes. So I'm going to start to wrap things up and close things up. Obviously, when we start to do something like this, there's way more questions introduced than we can possibly answer in 1 hour. I do want to remind everybody of the basic safety things that I stressed at the beginning. Basic safety says, don't work on electronics projects without a qualified adult standing by to help you to know what's safe and what's not safe. Electronics is wonderful. It's also dangerous, and you need to be respectful of that. Second important safety tip. In our project with the 9-volt battery, the 9-volt batteries are the only things that can get us in trouble. We don't want to leave the battery clip on the battery. Instead, we want to unplug the battery from the battery clip because we saw how the two leads could touch one another and create a short. And then the danger is heat, because the battery will get hot, right? You won't get an electric shock from that 9-volt battery, but you could, under the right circumstances, get a burn from that 9-volt battery, okay? That's the only way we can really get into danger with these circuits, besides possibly destroying some of our components, but what the heck. An LED costs about 8 or 9 cents, so electronics is a fun, inexpensive hobby. It's very inexpensive, especially when you're ordering on the internet. Okay? The parts for this kit, I think, were less than $3. Less than $5, because the breadboard is about $3. So less than $5 to get started with a kit.
Are you beta? Are you going to be introducing the Raspberry Pi into your curriculum?
I have a Pi, and I'm working on some Python programming classes using the Pi. I'm also working on building some classes with the Minecraft for Pi. I don't know if you've seen the free. They have a free. Yeah. Do you guys own a Pi?
Not yet.
Okay. They have a free port. That's the portable version of Minecraft, free for the Pi. But the one nice thing about it is that you can actually type commands in Python and have them go straight into the API of Minecraft. So you have the ability to issue commands, generating blocks in real time in there. So yes, it was a cool thing for that version. And hats off to the guys at Mojang for making that available to Pi users for free. It's a reduced version of the game. It's only creative mode and other things like that. Yeah. Barely even see it, right?
We should see it a little more than that.
No, I think we want to do this way. Yeah. All right, Adam, you can see a little more than that. No. Oh, yeah, this. So we have to choose this one. Yeah, we want to see a little bit of data. It's going to be less, but it's going to be a little bit, you know, like a flashbulb going on.
Okay, so thank you everybody for coming down and being a part of this workshop. Remember, the 9-volt battery does not go in the bag of your other components. It's not safe. If you want to make your 9-volt battery safe, help yourself with a small piece of masking tape there. Put that over the terminals on the battery. Make it nice and safe to go in your pocket. Up here is my mailing list. I really hope you all will sign up for it to get posts about it. This is information about summer camps I'll be doing this summer, including some fun camps about Minecraft. There is an electronics camp on the week of July 4th. It's a short camp. Monday through Wednesday, and if you enjoy this work, we're going to be doing exactly this type of work at the electronics camp. It's a 3-day camp on the week of July 4th.
I need to introduce you to my friend Tim, Aaron. You guys should know each other.
Hey, Ian, nice to meet you. Thanks for sitting in with us.
The baller one, is it safe just to put on the
ground? Yes, it is. Good question. Thanks everybody for coming out. Help yourself with some information up here. Mailing list up here. I'd love it if you could sign up for the mailing list to get updates about the computer programming club. Grown-ups and young people are welcome to the Computer Programming Club. All ages, all experience levels. Even if you've never done a bit of computer programming before, come down and hang out with us. There's usually some fun and interesting projects going on down there.
Will these be available on your site?
These images? No, I can make them. I'd love to do that.
That would be a cool thing. So we can go back.
All right. Yeah. Oh, yeah, that's great. Yeah. Hey, everybody, take my email address. Tom Heck had a wonderful idea about making the images from this slideshow available for people to be able to rebuild. And so that's a great idea. So please do sign up to the mailing list. Take my email address and get a hold of me via email so that when it becomes available, I can let you know. It was a thought that hadn't occurred to me. It's a great idea. And then you all will be able to rebuild it. So I'll try and build a, I think I can export this straight out to PDF. And then everybody who's grabbed the PDF of these images will be able to rebuild. Good morning to meet you guys today. Yeah.
What was the website? What was the website? Ian?
Take care.
What was the website? Ian, what was the website?
Tech-kids.com. Of course, thank you for being a part of it.